Hi, James Clements here. Now I'm going to take you through a simple but effective risk assessment and risk control strategy for any typical project. I mean, this is a simple system, but it's very effective on small to medium projects. And quite frankly, in my opinion, you don't need to get any more complex than this, because really, you know, if you're not doing risk management at the moment, then you need to start with simple systems, and you'll find that they're more effective, and you'll get a better buy-in from your people. So let's just run through this spreadsheet here on the screen. You can be using a software program, you can be using a spreadsheet, it doesn't really matter. I like to use a spreadsheet because I like to give everyone access to it, and quite frankly, it's something that should be shared amongst the whole project team. So you'll see here that we have three phases of risk assessment and risk control, which is risk definition. We identify the risk. Once you've identified the risk, you analyze the risk. Once you have analyzed the risk, then you control the risk. As simple as that. So we'd have down here our numbering. Once you type in your risk, then you want to be keeping that number aligned to that risk, so that when you put in your project reports, you can always refer to that number and refer back to it over time. So what we would do here is the first step would be to identify a risk. And I've got some examples up here, which I'll go through shortly. Identify a risk. Then you identify the causes of the risk. Ultimately, what you're trying to do when you treat the risk or mitigate the risk is you're trying to remove the causes and attack the root cause of why that risk is occurring. And if you can't minimize the cause of the risk, then you're trying to control the risk if it does occur. So you're trying to control the consequences. So identify the risk, identify the cause of the risk. If the risk were to occur, what are the consequences? So based on the causes, nominate the likelihood of that risk occurring. And then based on the consequences, you would then go through and nominate the impact if that risk were to occur. And once you've done that ranking, then you would get a rating for the risk. And then based on that rating, you would then decide, do I need to then control that strategy? As a rule of thumb, I always, anything moderate, high, or extreme always needs some kind of treatment. Anything that's considered low, let's just get a low one here. So if it's unlikely, it's minor, then you would get a low risk ranking. So something like that, you could probably just watch, and really the effort you would put into it's probably not worth it anyway. So you're really looking at getting the big ticket items under control. So once you've got your risks that you want to put some effort into, then you would come up with a risk control strategy. What are we going to do to either stop that risk occurring, or if it does occur, then what are we going to do to treat it when it does occur to minimize its impact? Once you've done that, then you want to give it an owner. Who is the best person positioned to manage that risk control strategy? So that's a very, very important point. If you just give it to some project team member who's got no authority, can't influence the project, he's not going to do anything about it. So, you know, here you're talking about your project managers, your quality managers, your engineering managers, your senior people in the project are the ones that need to be allocated risk control strategies. Then, when is that risk likely to occur? Is it date-based? Is it phase-based? Is it event-based? And similarly, when is that risk likely to have passed? Again, date, phase, or event-based. What you want to do here is, if you're nominating, this might be the engineering phase that a risk is going to occur, you want to be putting that in as an activity in your schedule so that you've got visibility of it. And then you know when it's passed, you can retire it. And then all risks are going to be open until you actually do retire them, and then you'll make them closed. Okay, so let's just look at some examples. So let's say we're building a fence. So we've got the Go Fence Limited fence building company, and the concern is that the fence will not be straight. There might be, the cause of that might be, there's insufficient care taken during alignment, fence foundation sink after installation. what is the consequences of that? What is the consequence of that occur? Hey, the fence will look bad, damage to our reputation, but I think most importantly, the customer may refuse to pay for the fence. So that's really the big ticket item there. You can put multiple consequences, you can put multiple causes, quite frankly, it doesn't matter. If you've got multiple causes, you need to address multiple causes. It's not binary. So once we've got the risk, what may cause it, what the consequences are, then we ask ourselves, how likely is it that the fence will not be straight? And we've said here, certainly it's possible. If the fence is not straight and the customer doesn't want to pay for the fence, what's that impact? And that is a major impact, or it could even be a severe impact. But regardless of that, really you've got an extreme risk. So if you can't sell off your product, then that's a major concern. Right, so we've nominated that as being extreme risk. So what are we going to do about it? And I've said here, as a risk control strategy, we're going to include hold points in the project inspection and test plan that requires review and sign off by the project client, foreman, and project manager. A, at 2 points in the project, at completion of the markout, and prior to foundation pouring. So we're stopping the project there, and we're saying, we want these people to put their name on the line that that fence is straight. At 2 points, once it's been marked out and once it's been made ready for pouring. The quality manager, he's responsible for the ultimate overall quality of the project. He's going to manage that risk control strategy, make sure those people come to the party, make sure that it doesn't occur until we get those sign-offs. So when would that occur? Well, at foundation digging and pouring, obviously. So we've nominated a date there. And then what would be the expected retirement date? 30th of January, so 2 weeks after that, we're giving ourselves a 2-week period where that's going to occur. We can put that in our schedule. The planner can then say, you know, a couple of weeks out of the project, don't forget we've got this concern on the project. We need to make sure we get all the right sign-offs, and for the time being, that risk is open. So there you have it. Very simply, if you start getting your project teams thinking about risks and their causes, think about what their impacts are, and their likelihoods, and then doing something about it, you are going to be so far ahead of the game, and you're going to get a lot better success and a lot better outcomes in your project.